Unit 4, Indian Judiciary. Honorable Sri Harihal J. Kania, first Chief Justice of India. The judiciary is one of the two beings of the legislature and the executive. Rakait Thirukural versus for Ball. In February, a Tamil Nadu court reportedly ordered 3 college students arrested in an assault case to recite 100 verses of Thirukural treatise by poet Saint Thiruvalluvar daily for 10 days as a condition for granting bail. One of the most significant contributions of the Madurai bench of the Madras High Court towards promoting the cause of Tamil is a direction issued to School Education Department in 2017 to make 108 out of the 133 chapters of Thirukural a part of school syllabus. The Madurai bench direction led to passing of a GO for teaching 1050 couplets to students from the academic year 2017-18. It also ensured that students from class 6 to 12 get to learn the couplets and their intended meaning in depth and not just specifically as was being done all these years. Thirukural is perhaps the only Asian secular text from India that has been translated into 60 languages the world over. Evolution of Indian judiciary. Judicial system to ancient India. Similarly, the clanes or tribal bodies like Grama, Gopa, Vishaya, Jana and Gana enjoyed autonomous powers. There were a number of Smriti such as Manusmriti, Narada Smriti and Yajnavalkya Smritis, of which Manusmriti was held as a core Smriti. Other Smritis had certain varieties. Judicial system in medieval India. In medieval India, the Sultan or Sultana was the supreme authority administering justice in his or her kingdom. He or she administered justice in the following capacities, namely Diwan-i-Qaza, arbitrator, Diwan-i-Mazalim, head of bureaucracy, and Diwan-i-Riyasat, commander-in-chief. There existed a systematic classification and organization of courts in medieval India. The administrative divisions were the basis for judicial organization. The King's Court, Diwan al Mazalim, Diwan e Riyalat, Sadr-e Jahan's Court, Chief Justice Court, Diwan e Riyasat. The Sadr-e Jahan's Court and the Chief Justice Court remained separate for long until amalgamated later by Alauddin Khilji. The Chief Justice's Court dealt with both civil and criminal cases, and the Chief Justice was assisted by judges who were men of ability and integrity and were greatly respected. Mufti Pandit Mohtasib in charge of prosecutions and Dartbeck administrative officer were the officers attached to the Chief Justice Court. The Diwan-i-Siyasat was primarily a court dealing with cases of high treason. The East India Company was incorporated in 1601 by the charter of Queen Elizabeth I. Once the company became a territorial power, especially at Madras, it introduced an ad hoc system of judicial administration in which the existing native systems were accommodated. As the company preferred a policy of non-intervention in native affairs, the governor and the council were empowered to decide on both civil and criminal cases in accordance with the law of England. However, in disputes involving only the natives, the native traditions were continued. The year 1665 was of great significance as it witnessed the first trial by jury in Madras in the case of Mrs. Assentia Davas during the governorship of Foxcroft. The appointment of Strainsam Master as the governor in 1678 resulted in the reorganization of the judicial system of Madras. The court of the governor and council came to be known as the High Court of Judicature, and English was declared as the court language. The charter of 1683 led to the company establishing courts of admiralty to try traders committing various crimes on high seas. The charter of 1687 authorized the company to create the corporation of Madras, and the mayor's court was attached to it. It functioned as a court of record for the Madras town. With regard to the administration of justice in Bombay, the charter of 1668 authorized the company to exercise judicial authority over Bombay. The proclamation of 1672 introduced English law in Bombay, and the court of judicature and the new central court was established. However, the invasion of Sidi Yaqub, the Mughal admiral, led to the dissolution of courts in Bombay in 1690. After 12 years, in 1718, the court of judicature was revived. The court has had jurisdiction over civil and criminal matters. Though the court met only once a week, it was highly regarded for its speedy trial and impartial decisions. Thus, the charter of 1687 applied only to Madras, while the charter of 1726 constituted a major court in each of the three presidencies. The charter of 1753 further reformed certain judicial provisions of the charter of 1726. It also set up five courts, namely the court of request, the mayor's courts, the court of the president, the courts of the president and the council, and the king in council. Another landmark in the evolution of Indian judiciary was the Warren Hastings Plan of 1772. It regulated the system of judicial administration. In 1780, he also reorganized the provincial adalats. The Regulating Act of 1773 empowered the Crown to establish the Supreme Court of Judicature in Calcutta, and the Charter of 1774 expounded on the jurisdiction of the court. However, the Supreme Courts were not established at Bombay and Madras during the same period. The Supreme Courts were established in Madras and Bombay in the year 1801 and 1824, respectively. In 1793, Lord Cornwallis prepared a set of regulations popularly known as the Cornwallis Code, and it dealt with both civil and criminal justice. He reorganized civil courts, abolished court fees, and reformed criminal courts. Lord Minto, after being appointed as the Governor General of Bengal in 1807, increased the powers and jurisdiction of the various courts. Lord Hastings, who became Governor General in 1813, introduced many reforms in the civil and criminal judicature of the country. Efforts were taken to curb red tapism in the administration of justice. He was succeeded by Lord Bentinck, who reorganized and consolidated the whole system of judicial administration in India. He abolished the provincial courts of appeal, and their functions were transferred to district Diwani Adalats. Between 1834 and 1861, the King's Court and the Company's Court formed the dual system of courts with separate jurisdictions. The Indian High Courts Act of 1861 empowered the Crown to establish the High Courts of Judicature at Calcutta, Madras and Bombay, and this also led to abolition of Supreme Courts. This was considered a landmark in the evolution of High Courts in India. Later, the Government of India Act of 1935 effected considerable changes in the nature and jurisdiction of the High Courts. The 42nd Constitutional Amendment Act 1976 brought in drastic changes in the jurisdiction of the High Courts. In 1921, Sir Hari Singh Gaud was the first person in the legal history of India to realize the necessity of establishing an All India Court of Final Appeal in place of the Privy Council. The Indian Independence Act 1947 resulted in the transfer of political power, and this necessitated the establishment of a separate and independent judicial body. With this objective, the jurisdiction of the Federal Court was enlarged and the abolition of the Privy Council Jurisdiction Act 1949 was passed, making the Federal Court of India the highest judicial body in the country. With the enforcement of the Constitution on 26 January 1950, Article 124 provided for the establishment of the Supreme Court of India. Thus, there has been a slow and steady evolution of the Indian judicial system, and it has proven to be better and wiser with time. India has only a unitary judiciary system, with the Supreme Court as the apex court, with authority over all other courts of India. Integrated judiciary. The Indian Federation, though a dual polity, has no dual judiciary at all. The High Courts and the Supreme Court constitute one single integrated judiciary, having jurisdiction and providing remedies in all cases under the constitutional law, the civil law or the criminal law. This is done to eliminate all diversities in the remedial procedure. Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. The President can seek its advice on any legislative measure. However, the advice of the Supreme Court is not binding on the President. Article 143. Organization of the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court of India has been established by Part 5, Chapter 4 of the Constitution of India. Articles 124 to 147 of the Indian Constitution lays down the composition and jurisdiction of the Supreme Court of India. By 2008, the number of judges have been increased from 8 to 30. As to the appointment of the Supreme Court judges, the Chief Justice of India should consult a collegium of 4 senior most judges of the Supreme Court. The collegium makes the decision in consensus. Every judge of the Supreme Court is appointed by the President after consultation with the Cabinet and the judges of the Supreme Court, and such judges shall hold office until they attain the age of 65 years. Justice K.G. Balakrishnan in 2000 became the first judge from the depressed class. In 2007, he became the first Dalit Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court of India, under the present constitution, commenced functioning on January 28, 1950. It was placed then in the Chamber of Princes in the Parliament. It moved to the present building in 1958. Harilal J. Kania was the first Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. The other judges who assumed office along with him Vice Justices Syed Faiz Ali, M. Patanjali Shastri, Meher Chand Mahajan, Bijan Kumar, Mukherjee and S.R. Das. The judges of the High Courts hold office until the age of 62 years and are removable in the same manner as judge of the Supreme Court. to be considered for appointment as a judge, one must be a citizen of India and have held a judicial office in India for 10 years or must have practiced as an advocate of High Court. Legal remedies for safeguarding fundamental rights. Habeas corpus. Mandamus. Prohibition. Certiorari. Quo warranto. Read these paragraphs. In the administration of law, judicial review in India has been very active. Article 13.2 of the Indian Constitution believed that countrywide shall not create any regulation. Those abbreviates are takes away the rights as deliberated in Part 3 of the Constitution. However, but in 2007, the Supreme Court ruled laws included in this schedule after April 24, 1973 are now open to judicial review cannot be conducted in respect of the laws incorporated in the 9th schedule of the Constitution. Any citizen of India can approach the courts for public case upon the interest of public by filling a petition under A. The Supreme Court by Article 32. B. In the High Court under Article 226. And C. In the Magistrate Court under Section 133 of the CRPC. The public interest litigation jurisdiction forged by the Supreme Court is an extension of its jurisdiction under Article 32 of the Constitution. In the Permanent Katara versus Union of India case, the Supreme Court held in the public interest litigation filed by a human rights activist fighting for general public interest that it is a paramount obligation for every member of the medical profession to give medical aid to every injured citizen as soon as possible without waiting for any procedural formalities. Judicial activism. As a dynamic process of judicial outlook in a changing society, Arthur Schlesinger, J.R. introduced the term judicial activism in 1947 in America in an article titled The Supreme Court 1947. According to Black's Law Dictionary, judicial activism is a judicial philosophy which motivates judges to depart from the traditional precedents in favor of new progressive social policies. Article 21 of the Constitution had been called up frequently in the Supreme Court. Judgments upon this article suggest the trends of judicial activism. However, subsequently in Menaka Gandhi versus Union of India case, this requirement of substantive due process was introduced into Article 21 by judicial interpretation. Thus, the due process clause. In Australia, the highest court is known as the High Court of Australia, while the state courts are known as the Supreme Court. The Indian Penal Code is the Criminal Code of India. It is a comprehensive code intended to cover all substantive aspects of criminal law. The code was drafted in 1860 on the recommendation of the First Law Commission of India, established in 1834. It came into force in British India during the early British Raj period of 1862. The objective of this act is to provide a general penal code for India. Indian Penal Code also provides for group liabilities, that is group liability under Section 34 in the form of a rule of evidence making each member of the group liable for the final act if he has in any manner participated in action in furtherance of the common intention of all members of the group irrespective of his individual contribution, which may have been very small. The information age has usurped in modern methods of criminal activities, which needs new methods of investigation and prosecution. For this, new criminal laws are needed. In view of this, the Indian government set up the V.S. Malimath Committee in 2000 to consider measures for revamping the criminal justice system in the country.